I welcome everybody, and a pleasure to have everybody. I know you always like to say the date, so it's Monday, May 9th. I'll say it for you. Monday, May 9th, 2022, and class 14 in our ongoing series on the traditional response to the rise of reform. Okay, Dr. Marc, is that an okay introduction?
Yes. Yes, very good. Okay, I want to start with something different than I usually start with. I'll get to that as well. Some comments, very interesting comments, questions, new points I saw. I want to share something with you that I discovered last week that I knew nothing about. And if I knew nothing about it, I'm sure many others knew nothing about it, but we have such learned people. Some of you might have known something about it. And I was just very surprised, and I'm going to share it with you. Let me begin as follows. Those of us in the New York area, we know LeFrak City in Queens. It was established by a very, very wealthy family, a man, Samuel LeFrak, and they're billionaires, the LeFraks. You can read all about it. The family is worth $6.6 billion, as it says here. They are Reformed Jews, although the next generation, I don't know what's going to be, because it was just 2 weeks ago in the New York Post, a divorce, Harry and Catherine LeFrak. She's clearly not Jewish. She's from a shipping heiress family. And in fact, Samuel LeFrak, who's the big one, if you look at some of the children, here you see, for instance, some are married Jewish, Denise LeFrak, Calicchio, so clearly not Jewish. By the way, I want to share something with you, because this will take us back. This song was written for Denise LeFrak. Okay, and you could read all on Wikipedia about it. So why do I mention this to you? Because I was at the New York Public Library last week. I'm just about finished my Rav Kook book, and I'm moving on to the next project. So I'm looking, I want to do, like I said, Halakhic History of America. So from my desk here, I have access to so much stuff online, but there's still stuff that's not available online. Early Young Israel, OU publications, and there's a publication called Mizrahi Veg in Yiddish, the Mizrahi Way. The only place I can get YIVO, but I don't want to go to YIVO. They have these crazy COVID restrictions, so I'm not going there. I go to the New York Public Library. They have the same microfilm. And by the way, there's stuff from the Rav in there, which no one knows about. As far as I know, no one knows about it. They just published the second volume of the Drushas of the Rav in Yiddish, edited by David Fishman. And he has references to things from the Rav in there, but I found something that's not in this book. And I went through every page, all sorts of great stuff. And look what I found there. Has anyone, hold on, I got it. Nope. Hold on. Here, look what I found. I had no idea about this. The patriarch of the LeFraks, the father of them, of Samuel, who made LeFrak City, his name was Harry LeFrak. I knew that. But what this says is the National Administration von Mizrahi Apol Mizrahi, that the Mizrahi Apol Mizrahi, who are they honoring? Harry LeFrak, der Greuser Askan for Torah und Zion, Chairman von Mizrahi Apol Mizrahi Chinuch und Expansion Fund. I had no idea of this. Harry LeFrak was the head, he was the chairman of Mizrahi and Apol Mizrahi. This is from. This is from the 1940s here, or maybe early 50s. I have to look. I think it's the 40s, I believe. I could tell you actually. Well, it says that this is their golden chasana, their 50th wedding anniversary. But unfortunately, there's no. Yeah, there's no entry in on Wikipedia for Harry LeFrak. But I'd never heard of this before. So if anyone knows about this, let me know that the founder of this billionaire family was very active, and not just active, one of the leaders of religious Zionism in America, chairman of Mizrahi, Apollo Mizrahi. Mizrahi and Apollo Mizrahi merged. That'll be in the 50s. This to me is completely unknown, and I just wanted to share that because I'm curious if anyone knows anything about this. Very interesting, I think. I listened to the tape. I just wanted to share a couple of things with you. Thank you to Yaakov Yellen for this next thing I want to share with you. It's hashgacha pratis, coincidence. I don't know. Remember last week we're talking about this Bible that said thou shalt commit adultery, and I gave it as an example that not every alternate version it preserves a real text. Sometimes just a printer's mistake. This is from May 2nd. So that was the very day that we spoke about it. Lo and behold, they found another one of these Bibles. It's called the Wicked Bible. I think it was Mel who mentioned the name of it because it omits and says the word not from the seventh commandment. There's only, when they found this mistake, of course, they had to destroy all of them. Only about 20 remained in circulation. So we spoke about this last week, and this was in, they discovered another one in New Zealand, believe it or not. So thank you, Rabbi Yaakov Yellen, for that. At the end of the class, I mentioned we were talking about partnership, women's tefillah groups, and I mentioned, I said that Rav Schachter's point was, sure he said it, and he did. It's in Ikvei Atzon, it's from his famous article on page 22, in which he gives a lot of reasons against women's tefillah group, and some of them are strong, I guess, if that's your inclination. But this one, I happen to think, B'mechiras Kvodo is weak. He gives like 7 or 8 of reasons, where he says that the problem with these women's tefillah groups is, he says that they don't have the kiyum of Kriyas HaTorah. If they went to shul, they'd hear Kriyas HaTorah with Baruch Hu. And that's what they should do. And my point was, but never in history were the women ever told you should go dafka to Kriyas HaTorah to be mekayim in the midst of Kriyas HaTorah. Even today, lots of times they come later. What I would have formulated if I was writing it, I would have said, granted, in the past, they never told the women to go to Kriyas HaTorah. So it doesn't make sense today to be criticizing women that they're not going to Kriyas HaTorah because their mothers never went to Kriyas HaTorah either. What I would have said was, if they're going to go to, if they think Kriyas HaTorah is important, so important they want to do it themselves, that is, they're already making the effort, then they should be going to shul. Because that shows that they're not like their mothers and grandmothers. They want to have a partner in Kriyas HaTorah. So that's how I would have formulated it. Now you should go, if you think Kriyas HaTorah is important, then you should be in the regular minyan. In other words, if that's the, I think that would be a stronger argument than the one he made that, they're missing out on Kriyas HaTorah because all the women who are not doing women's tefillah groups are also missing out on Kriyas HaTorah, or most of them. So I think he could have stressed the fact that these women are special because they dafka want to be a part of it, and then say, since you are already extending yourself, here's why you should be in the regular shul, not in the women's tefillah group. I think that would have made much more sense to make his point. So last class, if you remember, I said that I showed you the matseva of the Chazanit, if that's what they call it. And there's other matsevas where I mentioned it. So one of you, was it Shlomo, I think, or Shimon, asked me, do we have any matsevas of women Torah scholars? Because we have women Torah scholars. And I have to say that I don't know of any matsevas that speak of women Torah scholars. So like I said, we have Svarim that refer to a woman who asked this question, asked that question, gave that answer. But I'm going to show you something now that you've never seen. I guarantee you that. And I guarantee that no one listening who's going to watch it has seen, although maybe now you'll start seeing references to it, which is okay, I guess. How long am I supposed to hold on to this? I've been holding on to this for a long time, thinking one day I'll write about it, but I'm going to give it away now. So because this is unique. And there's been a lot written, a lot of people, that, and they keep collecting the same old sources. Was it the Drisha and the others, all the Rashi's daughter, all the references to the learned women. Here I'm going to show you something that totally new. Let's see, I pulled it up here. Here, nope. Here, okay. There's a sefer came out in the 19th century of Chuvos, published in Izmir, called Chaim Shanim. I have to read the introduction to see what it is. But in Siman Tes Zayin, believe it or not, there is a whole responsum written by a woman. A very detailed halachic response. And here, let me show you the title page of the book, and then we'll get back to here. I have to figure out if it's Chaim Shanim or Chaim. I think it's Chaim Shanim. From a Chaim Shlomo Tarsa. Don't know anything about him. Have to investigate it. If you see, it's the person who published it is writing from Rhodes. This is a well-known rabbi, Rafael Yitzhak Yisrael, but he just put it together. He didn't publish it. So now if we go to the page here, they found among the papers of the rabbi, what does it say they found here? A tshuva here from a woman. She begins, I would have thought perhaps when I read this, that maybe she didn't really write it. It's like a choshen mishpat issue presented to the rabbis to decide halachically. You could say, well, maybe she hired someone to write it. But if you see, I'll show you the response refers to her as the wise woman. She begins, ani ha'isha, merkada, basayakar, etc. And it's a whole discussion. So fine, maybe she didn't know all these sources, all these achron names. So she asked someone, she needs some sources, and they gave her the sources. I don't know the details, but what you have here is you have a whole tshuva, three-page tshuva, detailed halachic, discussing Yerushas and everything. And then you have the answer of the rabbi. You see on the left-hand side, Ra'isias HaShela, Vitzasher, I think it says, Nigzer Aleha Meis HaIsha HaKavoda V'Hatsnua V'Korin La, what is this woman's name? Chachma Merkada. And then he answers the question. So here, as far as I know, this is the only example before the 21st century where we now have a number of women who've written responses, where you have in the 19th century, not just responses are written, but published in a traditional sefer, a complete responsum with the answer, halachic argumentation back and forth by a woman. So, well, the people out there at Nishmat and Lindenbaum should take note of this. I also saw, for some reason, I said in the class that I mentioned Rabbi Jacob Schachter, we spoke about last week, and I said I knew him. I don't know why I said I knew him. I didn't know him. I think I meant that I knew of him. But this is the book I was referring to that he translated. Wonderful book, The Student's Guide Through the Talmud. Yes, I say I have a note here. I said I know him, but I don't know him. How could I know him? I think he died in the 70s and he was in Israel then. But Student's Guide Through the Talmud by the eminent teacher Zvi Hoffmann and R. Someone asked me, I think it was Ellen, how would they pronounce it in Israel? In Israel, they pronounce it chayot, which doesn't make any sense because despite the fact that Suf and Tuf are the same thing in modern Hebrew, his name was Chayas. That's how he spelled it. He pronounced it S. So it doesn't make any sense to start calling him chayot. That's not his name.
It's chayut.
Well, it's not chayut either. It's chayas. I mean, that's how it's pronounced. in Israel. Oh, you say how they pronounce it in Israel? Yes, chayut. Well, I don't know because if you go to the, I think if you go to the Harvard catalog, they transliterate it. Or the Hebrew University. I have to look. I know often it's transliterated as C-H-A-Y-O-T.
If I'm not mistaken, one of the people that was killed last Lag Ba'Omer, his family name is Chayut.
Chayut. But I don't know. I'm just talking about Tzvi Hoffmann and R. if you look, for example, the way people transliterated in scholarship, they often write chayot. Look, I don't know one way or the other how it is. As far as I know, he has no descendants. He had a grandson who was the rabbi in Vienna. I have to look into what happened with his children. Interesting how, if they survive, how they call themselves. But my point is that it's not, it shouldn't be written anyway, because his name, it was pronounced S. Anytime an Ashkenazi would have pronounced their last name with a suf as S, that's how they wrote it in the vernacular. So he wrote it in German, C-H-A-J-E-S, Chayus. I guess Chayus is Chayus, Chayut, I guess. But not with a tuf, though. It has to be with a suf, I believe, even if you're an Israeli speaking. So I would claim. Where we ended last class, let me get all my stuff here. We, if you recall, and this really finishes up with this area, we're going to move into something new now. And really, we're going to bring it to a close, part one of Reform today. And we are talking about twisting the truth for a good purpose. One of the things I cited, I cited Rabbi Elia Rusoff. I have the response in here. It's Ugat Eliyahu. If you Ugas Eliyahu, you go look at page 20. Here's just the question. Someone asked me on the telephone that the seventh day of his Avelos would come out on Shabbos, and they told him that on the seventh day, you only have to do an hour of Avelos, and he asked me if that's true, because he wants to know why. He wrote Selun Sol Beis Mischaro. He wants to go back to his business, because his wife, Eino Yodas Lanahal Beis Mischaro, she's messing everything up. So he has to go back to work on Shabbos. He said, the rabbi says, Rusoff, since I saw that in his mind, Avelos is more stringent than even Shabbos. And therefore, in order that he not violate Shabbos, I said to him that according to halakha, tzarich lenhog Avelos gam kol yom hashvi. The whole seventh day you have to observe Avelos. But the only thing is that you can wear regular shoes. Because it was on Saturday, you can wear regular shoes. But shardin Avelos no hay gam b'Shabbos kol yom. But the rest of Avelos, including I can't leave the house, applies the whole Shabbos. And then he says, but after I did this, I was wondering, did I do properly? He says, after I told him this lie that Avelos applies, I was wondering, maybe I violated the Torah commandment, the negative commandment, keeping four from full manner, from false matter, Shabbos. That is, I lied to him about the halacha in order to keep him from violating Shabbos. Was I permitted to do that or not? And then he explains how he was. And he goes through it, everything, and explains that under these circumstances, the masses, they don't need to know the truth. The more important thing is that they observe halacha. And we discussed a couple other matters. One of the things that we dealt with was electricity. I then got into the question of sometimes the rabbis don't want to give reasons, and they just want to say what the halacha is, because once they give a reason, then it becomes a suffix, it's a debate, you can disagree with the reason. And I said that I thought Rav Chaim Ozer Grodzinki, when it came to electricity, he said, we should just give the iser, but don't give the reason. And I was challenged, because it's known that he held that it's like fire. In fact, he would say Havdalah on it, on electric lights to show that it's fire. I found what I was thinking of and why I said that. And what I said was correct. And we need to distinguish between what Rav Chaim Ozer would say to the masses and in his discussions with the rabbis. Then he'll give his explanations. One of the first books, there were two early books. The first book on electricity, I think, is probably Rav Yudel Rosenberg's, Rabbi Kelman's successor in his rabbinic position. And I showed you that Ira Robinson from Canada, from Montreal, came out with a biography last year about Rav Yudel Rosenberg. He wrote the first book on halacha and electricity, and he even corresponded with Shlomo Zalman Auerbach, who wrote the second book. Now, he was an elderly rabbi at the time. Shlomo Zalman Auerbach was a young man. In fact, I'm holding right now the approbation of Rav Chaim Ozer Grodzinki. I just wanted to see now. Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach, I'm checking it, is born in 1910. So the Haskama here is from 1935. So at 25 years old, he has the Haskama. So he published the book. So the book was done even before he was 25. The stories are famous that Rav Shlomo Zalman, who had no secular education, but he would talk to the Hebrew University students and get details on how electricity works. And it's a fine sefer, your first one, Oreish. So what does Rav Chaim Ozer say in his Haskama? He says that I too have discussed this matter and how it's usher on Shabbos, of course, it's usher on Yom Tov, and I've explained it, but he says, but I don't believe we should have arguments, get into disputes, like Rav Shlomo Zalman takes on, let's say, Rosenberg, how do you define the usher, is it a raisa, is it a rabbanan, this and that. He says, why not? Because this will, raise doubts, because that's what I was remembering. There are Chaim Ozer, he just wants to declare an usher. Yes, the Shlomo Zalman, he's also writing it for the rabbis, but maybe there is a contradiction of Chaim Ozer. But here in this letter, at least, he says that we shouldn't debate it, shouldn't get into the back and forth. He even has a letter to a C.P.S. Frank, who wanted to be quite liberal when it came to electricity on Yom Tov. So that was what I was referring to. The final thing I want to mention before we go on these issues, because one of you asked me, I said that even Rav Ovadiah Yosef said that it's okay to not to let the masses in on everything, to twist it, I guess. And what am I referring to? Well, what I cited in my book, if you don't have it, I'll tell you right now. He says this in Yabi Elmer, but also in the approbation to the Alkut Yosef, the volume of his son dealing with Bikur Cholim. The question was as follows. You have an Ovel, someone in mourning, and he wants to get married before the period of Avelos is over, because he had not fulfilled Priya of Revia, having children. Can you have music at the wedding? Even within 30 days, Rav Ovadiah Yosef said, can you have music? And Rav Ovadiah holds 100%, you can have music at the wedding. Because, well, a wedding without music is not a wedding. And interestingly, in the tshuva, he speaks about the significance of music at a wedding. And that relates very nicely to what we did before. Remember, they said, the poskim said in Ela Debrabrit, there's no inyan of music in shul, but music at a wedding, that we know is essential. And then, in the tshuva, he responds to someone who said that... He responds to someone who quoted the Binyan Seal, and that's Yaakov Ettlinger. Rav Yaakov Ettlinger has a tshuva, number 139, I have it here somewhere, in which he says that an ovel, a mourner for his parents, in the first year of his wedding, he should not have music played at the wedding. And Rav Ovadiah says as follows. He says, if you read the tshuva, the Binyan Sion, it's Kuf Hametet, you see that the issue there is not the music. The issue is the mixed dancing. Because right afterwards, I have the Binyan Sion right afterwards, he says, it's good that you ruled not to have dancing and singing. And then he says, the Binyan Sion, if you can abolish all dancing at all weddings, Yasher Koach, because it's not a simcha when Bachurim and Besugos, when boys and girls are dancing together. So, and then he says it's of Israel de Arayos, and the Satan is among them. So it's clear that Binyan Siyam is not speaking about the issue there, Rav Ovadiah says, has nothing to do with Avegos. That's not what he's concerned with. And then Rav Ovadiah says as follows, and this is what I was referring to. He says that because the issue there was mixed dancing, therefore the Binyan Siyam wrote, the Binyan Sion gave a reason that Avegos, he mentioned Avegos there. Ki yadua, because it's known, the Pirshe Ainshe Mitame Avegos Yoser Misurim Gemorim. It's known that people care more about Avegos than more stringent sins, and they see this as a pugia in their honor of their parents. So therefore, Rav Ovadiah says the Binyan Sion was able to, even though he really didn't think it's a problem during Avelos to have a wedding with music for someone who needs to get married, but because here it was a case of mixed dancing, and they wouldn't listen to that, but they would listen if you tell them you can't have the dancing now because he's an Ovel, that they'll listen to. Ravadia says that that's okay. You're allowed to do that. You can change the justification. And look, at the end of the day, we twist things for all sorts of reasons. We tell someone their haircut is nice, even if we don't think so. We tell them the present they gave us is nice, even if we want to return it. We understand that in order to create shalom, you're allowed to do that. That's more important. That trumps the value of truth. And many of the poskim who adopt this approach say, "True, if you can twist the truth because of shalom between man and man, certainly you can twist the truth between shalom between man and God." And anyone who wants further details of this, I invite you again to look at my book, Changing the Immutable, the last chapter where I have so many sources and discussions where it really complicates the issue. But I want to now go back for a few minutes before we conclude this first part of our discussions, the rabbinic response generation one. That's what we're going to conclude, I believe, today. I want to discuss the organ issue and how it carried through even into the later generations, because the organ became the symbol of the dispute between the Orthodox and Reform. And there could be no compromise on this issue. Unlike, say, in Italy or in Prague, you know, hundreds of years ago, where these things developed naturally in the part of a traditional society, the Hatam Sofer and the other Gedolim, in my opinion, realized correctly that although some of these reforms could be justified halakhically, there's something more important going on here, because yes, you can justify this and that, but the entire effort of the reformers was about tearing down tradition, and it was not about ensuring continuity to traditional Judaism. So the motivations were wrong. So therefore, they thought it was important not to accept any of these things. And motivations are important. In my ethics class, I raised the following question, leaving aside the halachic matter, but we deal with taking someone off the respirator. And some poskim think you can take someone off the respirator. But leaving that aside, here's a case. Someone who knows that his grandmother is leaving him $10 million in her will, but she's on the respirator here, or the machine, whatever machine you want it to be. And she could live another 5 years on that. He goes in secretly at night and he disconnects her, causing her death because he wants to get his inheritance. See this, he could be arrested, charged with murder, all these things, terrible. On the other hand, let's say he loves his grandmother very much. She's not leaving him any inheritance, but he can't stand to watch her suffer like this. Like Clint Eastwood, that movie, I forget, I saw it on an airplane once with the female boxer right at the end of it, as I gave it away. But so you go into your grandmother, and you disconnect her, not because you want the inheritance, because you love her and you don't want her to live like that. Then people will look at that and have a very different view of it. Now it's the same action. And you could say, dvarim shebelevein and dvarim, but you know, what's in your heart doesn't matter. But I think we can all agree, leaving the halachic issues aside, and actually not, I shouldn't say leaving halachic issues, because this, I think, might have an impact on halacha if you think that it's permissible in those circumstances to remove the person from the machine. I think we can all agree that the reason you're doing it, the action is the exact same, but the reason you're doing it makes a great deal of difference. I want to show you something now to illustrate how central this the organ became. We know about the Berlin Rabbinical Seminary. Berlin Rabbinical Seminary was the place to get sinicha in Germany. You didn't have a yeshiva. Well, later you had a yeshiva in Frankfurt, but this is a yeshiva from the 19th century, and it provided the rabbis for all the communities, the separatist communities, the non-separatist communities. It was founded by Rav Zriel Hildesheimer, and then Rav Deutz Hoffman took over, Rav Avraham Melech Kaplan was the yeshiva rector, they called it, and then Rabbi Chayak of Weinberg until its closing. Everyone who graduated, who got smicha from the Berlin Rabbinical Seminary, you were given this document. Here's an example. This one is actually Rabbi, the author of the Shmir Shabbos Kol Chassar, Rav Neuwirth. His father was his grandfather was a musmach of the Berlin Rabbinical Seminary. And everyone got this. It says, Hoda Ne'amana. here's a declaring this for everyone. Now that you're leaving our base medrash, now you listen to what you were going to say, you know, follow the Torah way, don't go to the right or left. Your job is to sustain the Torah, et cetera, et cetera. But third paragraph, there are kahilos that have thrown off the Torah and they don't listen to the rabbis. And what did they do? They went with other religions, ways. Muhammad, Beis Hashem, you know, to establish in the shul instruments. And even to play them on Shabbos to desecrate it. And in the next paragraph, he says that this also leads to many other sins because it wasn't long once they put in the organ. So what happened then? Then all of a sudden you had choirs with women singers, and they took the prayer service, which we received from our forefathers, and they broke it down and took things out and add things. They rejected the promises of God to his prophets to bring us back to Zion, all the things we've seen. And then it says, if you, Haben Yakir Hanu, if you, new musmach, if you're called for one of these shuls, one of these irreligious shuls, he's saying, do not go to these shuls. You can't even go in those shuls. But and if you have already been in a community and the people then decide they want to institute an organ, you have to leave this. You can't stay there. And then it says, however, it says, and therefore today we're giving you a smicha because we're certain that you will follow these rules. Because you've shown already that you're faithful to God's word. But im chas v'sholom ruach ha-zacharis tavor alecha, if, however, you decide to take a shul with an organ. I mean, literally, it says any instruments, but we're referring to organ because that's the reality. They weren't playing guitars then. You should know and understand that all the smicha, the rishus, the smicha, which was given to you, miktav hatar Torah, which was given to you, but talin u'batalin lo sharin v'alkaimin. Know that your smicha is butal, is nullified. And this was given to every musmach already in the 19th century until the closing of the Rabbinical Seminary. Can you void a smicha? We have plenty of rabbis who graduate YU and other yeshivas, Haredi yeshivas, that they go off and do things that aren't proper. Have we ever heard of voiding a smicha? I don't even know, can you void a smicha? Once it's given to you, I've never heard of Yeshiva University declaring anything like that because it opens up a can of worms. Then it also then, even if you don't violate halakha, but let's say you become more liberal, Orthodox. You could see that Rebbeim would want to avoid the smicha because of that. So it opens up a can of worms. And I don't even know technically how you could void the smicha, but notice the Hodan Na'amana gets around this because it's not like they give smicha to someone and then 5 years later, 10 years later, they say, well, we don't like what you're doing, therefore we're removing the smicha. The smicha is given al tanai. As you saw, the smicha is given on the condition, it's stated at the time, it's a condition that you don't do this. And if you do violate what we're telling you and take a job in one of these shuls, then the smicha is batal. So what you have here is not a revocation of smicha. It's where after the fact, they look at it and say, well, we don't like what he's doing. It's built into the smicha itself, which and I think the reason for that is that it's clear then they have the authority to do that. Rav David Zvi Hoffmann, the head of the Berlin Rabbinical Seminary, author of the Malamid al-Hoil, the Chuvos, he was very, very strong against organs. This was an issue, of course, in Germany, because you had traditional synagogues that although they didn't play the organ on Shabbos, they wanted to play the organ during the week, let's say at weddings or a Chol HaMoed. We saw the video already how in Rome to this day they have the organ there. They no longer play the organ in Rome on Shabbos. They used to play with a non-Jew, but now they don't play it at all. However, they do play it on Hoshana Rabbah. I showed it for you. They'll do it at weddings. Well, in Rav David Zvi Hoffmann's responsa, Muhammad Ohoyo, Orachayim, number 16, he has a long tshuva here, talking about the organ. He goes through the whole issue of the organ in Prague, and he says that they told him the organ was in the Meisel synagogue, not the Altnoy, but we have other references that it was in Altnoy, and that's the whole story. Of why they do supposedly the Mizmar Shir twice in the Altnoy show. Unfortunately, we have to wait a while to go back to it. But then he says how the organs is forbidden because of Chukoseim, if you don't follow the path of the non-Jews. And then he says it's also forbidden because it's Chukos Apikorsim, it's the path of the irreligious. And then he concludes, and this is the big deal. He says, this is at the end of the tshuva, he says that this whole organ thing comes because they're trying to imitate the Christians. And he says that although you can play music, let's say for the king or at a chasana, but use other instruments, not the organ, because an organ has hukkos avodah zara, hukkos ha-goyim. And then he says, he goes on, he says, you can't use an organ even during the week. And he does say if a rabbi, because he's forced to, feels forced to, permits playing an organ at a chasana, or because, let's say, in honor of the king or anything like that, during the week, since he feels it's okay because it's not on Shabbos. He says that I don't believe that we should remove his smicha for that. That is, if someone is in a show where they're playing on Shabbos, fine. But if someone, let's say there's a lot of pressure and they want the organ, the Duke is visiting the show and they want to bring an organ in, it's wrong. You can't do it. But he says, because others have said it's okay in those circumstances, I don't think we should remove his smicha. But he needs to, this student or this new musmach still needs to publicize why he's doing it so others don't follow this path. But Rav David Zvi Hoffmann rules halakha l'maisa, you can't play the organ even during the week. Now, he doesn't say you can't play other instruments. He goes, in shul, let's say on Chol Hamoed, he doesn't deal with that. He's just dealing with, let's say, public events and weddings, where he talks about they'd want to use the organ. It's of interest, I think, that Rav David Zvi Hoffmann, although he includes at the end of it the different rabbis he asked who agreed with him, there's a number of them here, just well-known rabbis, Rabbi Hirsch in Hamburg, and Rabbi Bamberger in Kissingen, and all of them agreed that it's absolutely forbidden, except for Rav Mordechai Horovitz, the Matei Levi, the Rav of the Gemeinde, the larger community in Frankfurt. What did he say? If you look at the Matei Levi, volume 2, number 6, he is not so strong. Rav W.C. Hoffman wants to say that the organ during the week even is hukkos ha-goyim. It's a Torah prohibition. And Rav Mordechai Horovitz says he doesn't think so. He says... he says the reason that people want to declare it's Doraisa, why? This will remind us of what we just were speaking about. Ratzu idchok uvakesh is Doraisa k'deir achikam me'aveira. That is, the rabbis, Rav Zvi Hoffmann and others, they want to remove people from the organ, so therefore they push this that it's Doraisa. But it's really not Doraisa. And then Mordechai Horovitz says, and it didn't help them because the people don't listen, even if you say it's Doraisa. He says, on the contrary, what I want to do is us, he's saying, we want to show the Torah observing community why it's forbidden. And he says, Lama lanu levakish b'docha, kachar isa daraisa. Why do we have to push the matter, force the matter? Because why should it be forbidden daraisa? You can say that there's a good reason to use the organ. We're not using it to imitate the non-Jews. We're using it because we like the sound of it. And he says, "Dai lanu hu machmas shlus derabanan." He says, as far as we're concerned, we're religious Jews. If it's a rabbinic prohibition, that's enough. We don't need to invent a Torah prohibition. In order, Mordechai Horovitz is troubled by pushing this daraisa, and he thinks the only reason they're doing it is because it thinks it'll prevent people from using the organ, but he doesn't believe it's correct, and he doesn't really know if the people who are pushing it, they're using a dochak, he's saying. And at the end of the day, what's the matter? If it's a derabonin, we follow derabonins also. And then he says, that's about Shabbos we're talking about. And what about during the week, where Rabbi Hoffman also said it's usur midaraisa? He says, it's very difficult to say this because we know that in Prague, he says, they used an organ, Paska Moskadoli Olam, with the approval of great sages. And who can come after them? Mi avo acharem, hagichus adoraisa, mishum b'chol kuseyam. Who can say that you use an organ during the week? It's forbidden. Min ha-Torah, because of hukkot seyam, and we know in Prague they used it. And then he says, we know what the Marik says. And that's the view of the Marik is correct. The Marik holds that if you adopt something from the non-Jews and there's no immorality or idolatry, it's permissible. So it's not during the week, he says, there's not an issue here. It's not certainly not forbidden, mibchukos seyam, so what could be the problem? And then he says, very interesting, and va'ot, he says, ha'ech matzani yodin v'rogin v'esek nesesi matalar. He says, if you're going to say that's a problem using an organ because of during the week even, because of chukos ugoyim, he says, what about the fact that we wear this rabbinic gown? You all know the gown that the rabbis in Germany wore, and in America, many conservative rabbis, reform rabbis, even some Orthodox rabbis wore it, the long black gown. He says, he says, wearing this rabbinic gown, which even Rabbi Shamshon Raphael Hirsch wore, and the Matei Levi wore, and many, Bamberger wore it, Rizal Bear Bamberger, he wore the gown. And he says, this is worse than an organ. Why? The organ, menagdin gamba batei zemer b'concert. Oh, you know, with the organ, we know that they don't just do it for religious reasons. They also play it at the concerts. But he says the gown, who beget sheimbo tam kol. It has no other reason. And if the Protestants and the Catholics, you know, mostly we're talking about Lutherans, let's say the Lutheran, if the non-Jewish priests were not wearing these gowns. He says, we certainly would not wear it. So he's pointing out, if you're going to say that you can't have a play an organ during the week because it's ha-goyim, then how can we have wear the gowns? The gowns are even worse from that perspective. But the answer is going to be that even the gown, there's not a problem. And certainly not a problem with the organ. Because why are we wearing the gown? We're not wearing the gown to imitate we're wearing the gown because that in Germany is considered dignified. And that's the dignified look of men of the cloth, but we're not imitating them. We're not imitating an idolatrous practice. That's just that's the garb. Do you know that in England, they would wear I showed you pictures before, the collar, like think of the priest or the Anglican minister, the Jewish ministers will wear the collar also. No, because the collar is not related to idolatry. It's just a sign of the man of the faith, clergyman. That's the argument. You can see old pictures and you see them wearing it. And someone showed me a picture once, like from the 70s, and there was one old reverend still wearing his dog collar there. And you have the young rabbis. I remember by the 70s, you have rabbis that used to be just reverends. So he goes on then, and then he says that doesn't mean he doesn't like organ during the week. He thinks it's you shouldn't do it because harchek mina kior. But if someone were to come and ask me, and he says, listen, the issue is if we don't give him permission to use the organ in the synagogue during the week, they're going to fire him, and another rabbi is going to come, and this rabbi is going to permit not just playing an organ on Shabbos and Yom Tov, but also other Isurim, then we have to ask ourselves, well, what do we gain? here we could keep the rabbi in. They're going to play the organ during the week. If the rabbi says no, it's Issur D'oraisa, I have to leave the shul, then they're going to hire a rabbi who's not just going to allow an organ during the week. He's going to allow an organ on Shabbos, and he's going to allow all sorts of other things. So, nevertheless, he says that I don't want to permit it, but I tell you, you shouldn't say that it's usur. He says that because many rabbis had a different opinion on this. And he says that Rabbi Altman and Karlsruhe during the weekday in his shul, they would use an organ. Therefore, although I don't want to permit it because this is a complicated matter, we can't kick out people who follow this approach. He says, my opinion is you say that anyone in that situation, our opinion is that it's not the best thing to do. But if you, we can't tell you you can do it, but if you do it, we're not going to take away your smicha because of that. We see here there's a difference of opinion in Germany on this very issue. Horowitz agrees that today it's become the symbol of the heretics, the organ, so we should keep away from it. But there are times when it's a necessity. In the latest Hamayan that just came out, there's an article from Rabbi Duchovsky, from Shlomo Duchovsky. He was a very well-respected dayan in the Rabbanut and a moderate figure. He fought against this idea that you can avoid conversions, and very much of a mainstream figure, a great posek. In the last issue, he talks about certain matters that when you look at it at the beginning, you immediately will assume one thing, it's usur. When you examine it a little more carefully, you can come up with a completely different explanation. And he gives some examples. And the last example, which I remember, I can't remember the others now, is that he was a rabbi in Tel Aviv. In Tel Aviv, they have a zoo. And you probably pulled this up online. All the Hamayans go online. So the problem was the zoo's open on Shabbos. And they sell tickets. So they had, the religious were upset with this and they wanted to make different solutions. Either the zoo's, it's free, but if it's free, so then a lot of the religious, as I recall, he was saying, a lot of the religious said the easy solution is the zoo is free, but that's not the solution. Because what that means that people from all over Israel are going to be going driving their cars to go to Tel Aviv because then they could use the zoo for free. And that's going to create all sorts of Chilul Shabbos. What Rabbi Duchovsky thought would create the least Chilul Shabbos is keep the zoo open and charge admission for it. And that's, you might see that this is a strange answer, but he said that that's better than making it free. Because you make it free, yes, and no one at the zoo is then, they're not, this. Exchanging money, but that's a derabanan. But if you make it free, then you're encouraging everyone to drive from all over because they're not going to go to the local zoo. Let's say they're going to come to, I think the zoo's in Ramat Gan, actually. David can tell us where it is. Not in Tel Aviv itself. But I think many poskim might disagree with this. I think they would say just the opposite. If the city, let's say it's Ramat Gan, we have to do what's halacha. And halacha is you can't sell tickets on Shabbos. The fact that these people all want to drive and are violating Issur D'oraisa, that's not our problem. They chose to do that. But we, the community here, we can't allow anyone even to violate a rabbinic prohibition. This gets to the old issue we've discussed so many times. Remember the Shabbos bus question? All these people are driving the shul on Shabbos. So you come up with this idea, or Jackson Cohen wanted to in Florida, that the shul hires a bus driven by a non-Jew. And the bus goes around and picks up the people. At the most, it's a rabbinic prohibition. But the rabbis rejected this because they said it's one thing if the people drive their car on their own or take a cab. But how can you have a shul actually set it up, even if technically it's lessening the sins of all the people, but the shul itself was involved with this. And what I would say to Rabbi Duchovsky, it's also something we pointed out many times. This goes back to the famous comments of the Akedah Sitzchak. You had communities in Spain, at least one community, but I recall it was more than one, where you had a problem because the men were going to the non-Jewish prostitutes And that that could be the death penalty, and it created all sorts of problems. So you had this community that established, the rabbi agreed to it too, that you establish a, for lack of a better word, a whorehouse, a Jewish whorehouse. The prostitutes go to the mikvah. Everything is fine. And that lessens the sin. And the Akedah Sitzak there said that even to raise this as an issue, and there was, at least in that community, the, under rabbinic guidance, they thought that that was okay. He said that this is the biggest disgrace of it all, because when you deal with matters like this, you're not looking at what technically is more of a prohibition or less of a prohibition. The very fact that the community itself would give justice, it would justify this practice and make it official and arrange it, that gives it the imprimatur of the community. So I would say the same thing to Rabbi Duchovsky. And by the way, if he was a Haredi, I get it, because what does he care what, you know, if the state of Israel was violating it, you know, that to him doesn't have, wouldn't have such a meaning. But he's actually a Zionist, Rabbi Duchovsky. I have a letter of his, which I found in the archives, in which he affirms that he's a Mizrahi right. So I would think, I'm a little surprised that he doesn't see the problem with the city, the municipality itself, having a system where there's Chilul Shabbos. But I encourage anyone who's interested to look at the tshuva, the article he has. Now we're going to come back to the Hatam Sofer, Moshe Sofer Schreiber, when we look at his view of emancipation. When we get to a next generation, one of the big issues here is emancipation, and do we accept it? Do we want to be part of this new world? Because the reform argument is that the traditionalist Jews, they're Jews of the ghetto, they're Jews of the past. If you want to be a modern person, you need to be you need to come in our direction. And it's Rav Shamshon Raphael Hirsch is going to provide the greatest response to this, that no, you can be a 100% traditional Jew and also take part in the world, everything that's on there. But the Moshe Sofer, as we'll see, provides, and he's not unique in this, there's many who felt the same way, the justification, dafka, for the reform argument that the traditional Jews only want to remain in the ghetto. And there's no question, as we shall see, further as we move on, how he's a pivotal figure. He did a great deal in holding back the danger of reform. He gave sustenance to the traditionalists. But his approach, by the time you get to the mid-19th century, his approach is not going to be helpful in pushing back the tide of reform, because the traditional Jews are not going to want to live in the ghetto. We're going to see what the Hatam Sofer actually says. And as the 19th century goes on, you need a new approach. And it's very interesting when you read the Hatam Sofer, he has, I don't know what you call it, a certain, even though he lives into the third decade of the 19th century, a certain naivete that works fine in the ghetto, but the idea that this would work outside the ghetto among more westernized Jews, it wasn't going to work. And I believe maybe the Hatam Sofer is just fine with having his 10% or even less committed Jews, but this wasn't able to, when you deal with a place like Germany, where everyone is now speaking German and wants to be a professional, and the approach of the Hatam Sofer just wouldn't work. And even the Hatam Sofer, in many ways, he still has the pre-modern mentality, even though he's living well into the 19th century. So for example, just to give you some examples, which shows the things that would never been able to have been said by Rav Shamshon Raphael Hirsch, Rav Israel Hildesheimer, Rav Nassim Adler of London, to be distinguished from the teacher of the Hatam Sofer, that who were modern rabbanim with modern educations. All of them had the two of them had doctorates. And Nassim Adler, I think, had the first doctorate of modern times of German Orthodox types. He received a doctorate from Erlangen University, as I recall. I have material, which I got from the archive there. But to show you, just to give you some examples, how the Hatam Sofer really is, he's pre-modern. So for instance, the Hatam Sofer says that, I'll just give you some famous examples, that he questions whether the results of Gentile, and that was a time when scientists were studying anatomy very seriously. He questions whether the results of scientists who are studying human anatomy, we can use them. Because after all, Jewish bodies have only consumed kosher food, and we don't give our bodies to be operated, dissected on. So he questions whether you can use anything the non-Jewish doctors say, because they're not referring to Jewish bodies. He actually, in the early 19th century, he leans towards Ptolemaic astronomy. He's He acknowledges the issue is complicated, but he does not reject Ptolemaic astronomy. He's not 100% certain, because he knows that there are certain rabbis who also lean to Copernicus. But he leaves it as an open question. He writes that Yiddish as a language was intentionally invented by medieval Jews to keep them away from the non-Jews. So now these type of ideas, they don't really reflect a modern sensibility. I want to give you one more example. I'll end with this, which something which would be well known to all. You know what? I'm already seeing it's 9:26. I'll get to you next time. And we're going to finish next time with this. And we're going to begin already in next class with moving into the next generation. But I want to show you something really interesting from the Hatam Sofer and then from Moshe Feinstein. A few more things. But I see it's already 9:26. I don't want to keep you. Let me make a mark here and take the questions here, comments, which I learn so much. Yerachmiah, you see the pronunciation of frak as the accent in the first syllable, but the reason I didn't say that is because if you look in Wikipedia under LeFrak City, it says pronounced LeFrak. So I agree with you that, because I'm from New Jersey, that usually say LeFrak City. But the question is, how does the family pronounce the name? My father has always said there was a president of the United States, Pierce, and was it Franklin, I believe? I forget now his first name, but his name was actually pronounced Purse. So at least that's how he pronounced it. If anyone knows the LeFraks, you can ask them, is it LeFrak or LeFrak? It's like the, is it the Van Wyck or the Van Wyck? Well, it's the Van Wyck. That's how it's pronounced. But Van Wyck is how many people pronounce it. Or how about Faneuil Hall? As my father, an American historian, has told me originally, the proper pronunciation is Funnel Hall, even though it, that's not what it is. So, and Susanna also says LeFrak City. Now, by the way, the Wikipedia could be wrong. Wikipedia, it's always, if I were to go on right now, as soon as we're finished, I can edit it and change it. And that becomes the new Torah Misinai. So just because it's on Wikipedia, but that's why I called it LeFrak, simply because that's what I saw on the Wikipedia. Oh, Paul mentioned the New Zealand discovery last week in his online chat during the talk. You know, I didn't get to all the online chat, so I'm sorry. Thank you for that. You get the credit. Rivka asks, is it known where Sarah Schneer is buried? Yes, it's known where she's buried. And the Matseva is an interesting thing because the Matseva was destroyed and they had to, I think Schneer Lyman has an article on this, they had to reconstruct it by memory, I believe. I'll get you the details on her matseva last class. They wouldn't say that she's a chacham, a female chacham. They would say she's a spreader of knowledge, I believe, because a chacham is one who, well, I'll see what her matseva is.
There's a later post that actually links to her matseva in the chat.
In the chat, okay. Yeah. So we'll have to look at that. Schneer Lyman is responsible for resetting this matseva. Chaim Schneim. Okay, so thank you, Moshe. I didn't know the reference. Okay, that's the pronunciation. David tells us that the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court is Esther Chayut. Now, was she related to the Maritz Chayas? That's the question. It's a good question. Is she related to him? We'll have to see. And Paul says that among Chayas' descendants, he had a student in London who claimed that he was directly descended, but the family name was Vosner. I mean, it's an important family in Vienna, the Zvi Peretz Chayas. So he was the chief rabbi of Vienna. Should be able to find it. And Rabbi Cohen mentions about Yudo Robinson. Now, Rabbi Yellen says, Ira Robinson's book, Yudo, is $119. Well, there are certain publishers that basically, they market to libraries. So they that's why they make it. Hopefully, this book will go into soft cover and then it'll be affordable. Right now it's not affordable. I was able, because I have a series with Academic Studies Press, I was able to get a free copy, but I sympathized. I would not buy it for $100. That's what libraries are for. So I thank you very much, Yerachmiel, for giving us the matseva here. And if you go to, I'm going to pull it up for everyone to see it now. Yeah, so it calls her the tsnua, the tzadkanis, and it quotes what's in her tzava'a. It says, right, the Matseva was destroyed during the Holocaust and was set up again in 2003. But they, all they had was, as I recall, I have to look again, all they had was from memory what it said, and they didn't actually have a text. It's not just that it exists. It now was a place of pilgrimage. I don't remember if how much you spoke about it, but the very first class that Naomi Seidman gave, you can see it on YouTube for Torah in Motion, she spoke about, I believe it's the first class, going there and meeting all the Beis Yaakov girls. It's now a place of pilgrimage. Hold on, let me go back for a second here, a couple things. Was organ an issue before mechitza? Oh, 100%. Mechitza doesn't only becomes an issue in the 20th century in America, really. In the 19th century, you had it in Albany, Rabbi Isaac Meir Wise, but it really becomes an issue in the 20th century. But organ was already the 19th century. Yes, Rabbi Hartman mentions with Skokie Yeshiva Varon Soloveitchik, he wanted to revoke smicha of a student who became a rabbi in a shul without a machitza. It's a great dispute between Howard and Skokie. If you recall, this takes us back now many, many classes. I showed you unpublished material on this that I discovered about Rav Aaron and the letter he writes. He writes to the traditional shul that this rabbi you hired is a scoundrel. You shouldn't keep him on. He lied to us. He said he wouldn't take such a position. It led to a great dispute because the yeshiva itself in Skokie supported these graduates going there. Clericals, yes, that's what they're called. Thank you very much. Someone privately texts me about a well-known Orthodox smicha that Rabbi Riskin, he revoked the smicha he gave to Mark Gaffney. If you don't know who Mark Gaffney, Mordechai Winiar's is, I think it's okay to mention the name. You can just Google it and you will see, unfortunately, what was involved with. But this person privately says, doesn't think the Rabbanut revoked the smicha. I don't know if Rabbanut's ever revoked smichas. Someone says bordello. Okay, that's a better word. You're right. Yerachmiel says the Chasam Soror lived in a cosmopolitan Habsburg city. What was the interaction with modernity? That is true. And all I can say is, hey, we can't answer that now. I have 8 classes, I think, on the Ramosha Sofer, the Chasam Sofer, and I'll get back to that. But he was not living in some, shtetl removed. Okay, so Yerachmiel says it's LeFrak city, but Samuel LeFrak. If that's the case, I don't know. We have to confirm it. The whole reason for me mentioning this is because I had no idea that the patriarch is Yarev Shalem, a good Jew. And unfortunately, like so many of his generation, the descendants drifted further and further away. David, thank you. David tells us the zoo that had free entrance on Shabbos and that Rav Dachovsky told the municipality to charge admission on Shabbos to minimize the masses that would Dafka drive there on Shabbos was located in Gan Eir, due north of the Tel Aviv municipality. It operated between 38 and 1980 until it closed, and the animals were relocated to the safari in Ramat Gan. Yes, I did mention that. I did remember that he mentions those. Now, someone privately says Wikipedia does not mention Rav Nosson Adler had a doctorate. Well, because there's 2 Rav Nosson Adlers. You're looking the person who texted me, Rav Nosson Adler, the teacher of the Chasam Sofer. He definitely did not have a doctorate. But look under Rabbi Nathan Adler, the first chief rabbi of England, the author of the Nesina Lager. He had a doctorate. Mel, yes, look under, not that Nelson Adler, look under, they probably have it under Nathan Adler. And we have Paul with us. I'm sure Paul could provide all sorts of information about Rabbi Nathan Adler. And finally, again, Gershon, we're not speaking about that, not Tan Adler. We're speaking about, and I don't know if he would have pronounced his name as Natan. he probably would have pronounced, maybe would pronounce it as Nathan. I don't know. No, I'm not squeamish about the fact that Gaffney. I'm just saying I don't like to talk about these things. It's just they're disturbing that someone with smicha who you would have said in his early years he's going to be one of the people we're most proud of, and a great man. Is going to be a great man to influence the Jewish people. Everyone had high hopes for that. It turns out to be a menuvel shabim menuvelim, and not once but numerous times. So. That's why I don't, it doesn't give me much pleasure. By the way, there's a scandal going on now in Germany with the Reform, where the same sort of type of thing, where the head of the Geiger College, where they trained Chazanim and rabbis in Germany, that he also got caught up. And many have fallen, unfortunately, by these sorts of things. Well, I think we've gone long enough. I want to thank you again for coming out. I don't see Rabbi Kelman with us.
Here I am. What do you mean you don't see me?
Okay. Someone else's picture.
No, you don't have to see me. That's fine.
Well, because usually your picture is the one I see.
I don't know why you don't. That's interesting.
It was in the big screen, not you. So
okay. Nice. Okay. Oh, you have it on speaker view.
Yes.
As opposed to on gallery. Okay, whatever. That's so. Here I am. I'm sure nobody. Okay. Very good. Yeah. Okay. We can end on always cheerful notes. All the good people who are charismatic and do positive things. But okay, tomorrow, Markus Simkowitz at 2:00, Dr. Markus Simkowitz, 2:00 Eastern, continuing her series on the ancient Judaism. And then Michelle Chesner at 8:30 at night on her series on manuscripts. And she's the librarian for Jewish studies at Columbia University. That's tomorrow. Then Marty Lakshin, Rabbi Shulman, Moshe Sokolov on Wednesday, Thursday. Thursday, I mentioned Benny Gesundheit is starting a three-part series on Shavuot, and we'll send out also Mark Trencher will be talking about his most recent survey hot off the press on the relationships of singles to the Orthodox community. I don't think I have to tell anybody here what an issue that is, and I'm sure many people on a personal level, not on a personal level, you know other people. So he does all these you know research stuff. He's spoken for us a couple of times before. He does scientific research. On he surveys people and he collates the responses and puts out a report. So his latest one is on the singles in the Orthodox community. So he'll be speaking about that Thursday at 1:15 p.m. And then Nitti Linzer, who's graduating from Princeton, probably next week, I think is the graduation, will be learned in Migdalos. We'll be giving the Parsha Shir on Thursday and then my Shir on the Siddur on Friday morning. Okay, that takes us to the end of the week. And we look forward to learning with you. And please invite a friend. And everybody be well. Hope everybody's doing well. And Shavuot Tov. We should hear good things. Thank you very much, everybody. Laila Tov.
Toda Rabba. Laila Tov.
Bakasha. Okay. Bye-bye.